Good morning and welcome to this hearing of the Committee on Governmental Operations. I'm the Chair, Ben Catlis, and as always, you can tweet me with feedback, questions you want asked, at Ben Catlis. You can also feel free to email. Today we'll be holding a hearing on four introductions. First is Introduction 90, sponsored by Councilmember Alan Mizell, in relation to requiring certain agencies to be capable of issuing warnings. For those paying attention to the Criminal Justice Reform Act, this is something we'd like to do as a city moving forward, and this legislation is what we need to do so. Moving forward, folks would actually be able to draft legislation that would offer people an entitlement to a specific number of warnings before an actual violation could be issued. The second is Introduction 264. It's also sponsored by Councilmember Alan Mizell in relation to transferring the Parking Violations Bureau from the Department of Finance to the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings. This follows similar suit as we've been doing with other agencies. As many folks would prefer to go before a judicial or quasi-judicial body to find out whether they're guilty or innocent versus having to go before the collections agency, which would be Department of Finance. Third is Introduction 294, sponsored by Councilmember Julissa Ferreras-Copeland in relation to limiting the fees charged by the city for making online payments. And fourth is Introduction 1091 that I've sponsored in relation to amending references to the tribunal functions of the Environmental Control Board to include a reference to a consolidated administrative tribunal of the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings. All four of these bills are seeking to adjust the operations of our city government to provide better and more efficient services to the public. Introduction 90 seeks to do so by ensuring that agencies are capable of issuing warnings the first time a condition is observed. In the past, the council has been told that some agencies did not have equipment capable of recording that a possible violation was observed and a warning issued, so in the future inspections where the same condition was observed, they could issue a notice of violation. The council has tried to ensure fairness when laws and regulations change by requiring outreach and public information campaigns so that business owners and public will not find out about a new requirement when they are paying a financial penalty for having unknowingly violated it. The ability to more effectively issue first-time warnings might also allow us to include them in laws more often and would allow for greater fairness in our enforcement of actions. Introduction 264 seeks to move the Parking Violations Bureau, the agency that adjudicates parking tickets, from the Department of Finance, where it's currently located, to the Office of Administrative Trials and Hearings, also known as OATH. For those unfamiliar with OATH, describe the mission of the independent agency in the words of its own commissioner and chief administrative law judge. OATH's function is to provide due process in a forum that is in fact and in appearance truly neutral and unbiased. They are an agency solely dedicated to providing unbiased hearings for the public when they wish to challenge a civil summons or notice a violation that they have received from a city agency. These tribunals used to be located within the agency issuing the violation so that if, for example, you received a notice of violation from Department of Consumer Affairs and wish to challenge it, you would have to go to a hearing held in the office of the Department of Consumer Affairs and which was adjudicated by a hearing officer hired by the Department of Consumer Affairs. The appearance and reality of bias in such arrangements where agencies were both enforcers and judges led over a period of several years to these tribunals being moved out of their agencies and into OATH. Now an agency can issue a notice of violation, but the determination of its validity is made by the impartial judges at OATH. The most significant tribunal that has not yet been moved to OATH is the Parking Violations Bureau. Unlike the Department of Consumer Affairs, for example, as I mentioned earlier, the Parking Violations Bureau does not issue the parking tickets that it adjudicates, so it may have a greater degree of impartiality than some of the tribunals did, but it is located in an agency that includes among its responsibility the collection of revenues for the city, and in a brochure it describes its mission as helping people, quote, pay the right amount on time, and end quote, and determining, quote, what the right parking ticket amount is by providing a fair and independent forum, end quote, for challenging a parking ticket. Such a mission statement, which focuses first on the idea of a person paying some amount for their parking ticket, makes for a poor comparison with OATH's mission statement of ensuring due process for the public. Introduction 294 seeks to place a cap on the convenience fee that the city can charge for credit card payments made online. Currently, except where exempted under the Department of Finance rule, the city charges a universal 2.49% convenience fee for credit card transactions. This fee is meant to cover the interchange fees charged by banks and credit card companies to merchants who accept their cards. The bill would seek to limit this fee to 2% or less in some circumstances. Introduction 1091, which I've introduced, would amend the references to tribunal functions of the Environmental Control Board to include references to an authorized tribunal of oath to better reflect the reality of a consolidated tribunal structure within oath. The roots of this bill can actually be found in a law council passed in 2008, which moved into oath the Environmental Control Board, known as the ECB, which, among other responsibilities, held hearings on notices of violations from several agencies. Under that law, the chair of ECB is now the chief administrative law judge of the oath, and oath uses the same rules and processes that apply to its other hearings for ECB hearings. Yet, for vestigial historic reasons, the term ECB remains in our law. This can prove confusing to the public, who may receive a notice to appear before for a hearing before the ECB, only to arrive at a building that says oath. You should not have to learn about the bureaucratic history of an agency in order to be able to navigate it. This bill seeks to remedy that confusion by amending the law to state that since the ECB is located with oath anyway, an authorized tribunal of oath may carry out the hearing. I believe that oath has done a tremendous job in recent years in reducing confusion for the public, and this law seeks to help them further that goal. Just to restate this in plain English, people get quality of life violations. Those quality of life violations are called ECB violations or summonses. People show up looking for the Environmental Control Review Board and for the Environmental Control Review Board hearing where they can appear, and no one knows what they're talking about because they're standing in front of an oath building talking to security guards at an oath building who, when you ask, "I'm here for my ECB violation," they say, "We don't know what you're talking about." So this would actually fix that. I'd like to acknowledge members of the Governmental Operations Committee currently present, Carlos Menchaco, who's taken the lead from Joe Borelli as being the first member here. We've also been joined by Antonio Reynoso following some text messages from myself and Carlos, and we're glad to have you here. That being said, this hearing was noticed 6 days ago, and so the administration, for whatever reason, has not provided testimony in person. They've provided in writing, so that is now on the record, and anyone here is welcome to get a copy. Do we have them with the sergeants at arms? Perfect. Yes, please, if we can distribute it to members of the audience. And we've been joined. If you're interested in testifying today, please see this sergeant at arms who is handing out the testimony and fill out an appearance card. So we have one, so I'll invite that individual to testify. So Joseph Fama from Empire Commercial Services.
Good morning. Thanks for holding the hearing. Thanks for the opportunity to speak to the council. My name's Joe Fama. I own a company called Empire Commercial Services. And if you would permit me, I'd just like to give you a little background and my expertise in the field of parking violations. Way back in the day, I was an official with the city. I was an assistant commissioner for parking violations. Under Commissioner Joe Bruno, who you may know, and I was part of the cleanup team after it was a very large parking violation scandal. I spent 4 years there from 1986 to 1990, then became a special assistant to the budget director for revenue. And then in 1992, I left city government and started Empire Commercial Services, initially to assist commercial entities in complying with New York City regulations regarding the operation of commercial fleets. We've developed in the last 25 years into the largest parking ticket processor in the city, other than the city of New York, for both commercial entities and individuals. Empire doing the commercial part, and our company called WinIt, which is a phone app that assists the general public. And we process now about 30,000 parking violations a month and conduct a hearing on each and every one with the Department of Finance. So I would first like to say that the individual judges and the chief administrative law judge for parking tickets at Department of Finance do a terrific job. It's a difficult job. It's high pressure, high volume. They know the laws very well. They apply them very well. And I believe that Commissioner Gatsopoulos, who's the chief administrative law judge, is excellently suited for her job and serves the city very well. I am in favor of the move, however, to oath for two reasons, one of perception and one of reality. I think there is a bit of a chilling effect, especially for members of the general public, to respond to parking tickets and to go for hearings at the Department of Finance. I think it's a chilling effect because they view it as a collection process and are less confident in the hearing process. I think it's more an issue of perception than substance. Nonetheless, I think it is a real problem that I think the council is trying to address, and I think it's a good idea. In terms of the reality and what that affects the perception is the Finance Commissioner has some very broad discretion. Fortunately, I think we have an excellent Finance Commissioner today in Commissioner Jiha, and I think the city's administration has really worked hard and produced some very good things to help the general public and the business community with parking violations. The prior administration under Commissioner Frankel, not so much. And it's kind of the concern that I would have with the Department of Finance that we're lucky to have a great commissioner today. We don't know what comes down the road. One of the reality problems is that Commissioner Frankel had put out an edict that says the administrative law judge for parking violations no longer has the discretion to waive penalties when a respondent goes in for a hearing. That's a penalty above and beyond the base fine of the ticket. For many years, going back to 1976 when the administrative tribunal was created, the administrative law judge always had the ability to find someone guilty on a ticket, but had the ability to waive the penalties. I think part of the chilling effect under finance today is that the judge no longer has that discretion. Penalties are designed to coerce compliance, not to draw every nickel out of every person who shows up. My own belief is that if someone is attempting to comply and appears for a hearing and the computer has posted a penalty, the judge should have the discretion to remove that penalty. I think that would help the perception in the hearing process, even if it were to stay at the Department of Finance, that I'm getting a fair shake, somebody's listening. So I would hope that if the city in its wisdom does move the process to oath, that the ability of the judge to be independent and address a penalty issue would be something that would be allowed. In most oath hearings, not only does a judge deal with penalties, a judge can actually set the fine. Okay, so there might be a range. It could be a $1,000 minimum and a $3,000 maximum. The judge determines what the fine would be. In the parking ticket world, we're really only dealing with relatively small dollar amounts of penalties. The first penalty level is $10. The next one is another $20 to a maximum of $60. I believe that if John Doe citizen shows up for a hearing, they are making their best effort to comply, and that should be taken into account and not penalize every respondent who wants a hearing by assessing the penalties. So I think we have an issue of perception and then an issue of reality, and the reality being the penalty issue. When I was with the Parking Violations Bureau, because it was such a tremendous scandal, we opened up with an amnesty program, which drove compliance and revenues through the roof, because people felt then that they were going to get an honest and fair shake. I'm not suggesting an amnesty program, but what I am suggesting is that the administrative law judges, who I think really know the law and do a terrific job applying it, should have the ability to waive penalties at their discretion based on the testimony of the respondent. I think that would resolve a big problem that we have and why the council is really considering moving everything to oath. I understand the volumes for parking tickets outpace anything else by miles, and that might be a reason why you might not want it to go to oath. You might not want to overburden it with the parking tickets, but if we determine that it will stay with finance or go to oath, I think the ability of the judges to waive the penalties is key. And in fact, if I were creating legislation or policies, I would probably mandate that the penalties be removed for any respondent who's showing up for a hearing, so that the public knows there's a benefit for me to go plead my case, at least get the penalties removed. We've done a great job with finance in terms of access for the public. You can now do hearings online, by mail, in person. There are all sorts of ways to try to comply, and I think giving the judge that ability will increase compliance and increase collections. So based on my years of experience with Empire, processing 30,000 tickets a month, and about half of them for the general public through our phone app. This is the feedback that I get. I get it from the commercial entities as well. Most commercial entities want to be good corporate citizens. The companies we represent are very large, companies like Poland Spring and DHL. They want to go in, they want to clear up their tickets. They pay tremendous amounts of money for the tickets of the found guilty. They want to be good corporate citizens. My company, we provide training for their drivers on what to do if you get a ticket, how to avoid tickets, where to park, where not to park. We all know the realities of trying to operate within the five boroughs. Tickets are a fact of life. And most of these companies are doing their best to comply and take care of their tickets. And I do believe that the penalty issue is one that will encourage compliance if there's an ability for the judge to review it and remove the penalties, whether it's under oath or whether it's under Department of Finance. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Thank you very much for your testimony. I want to note that we've been joined by Councilmember Mark Levine. I want to express regrets from Councilmember Alan Mizell, who wanted to be here and cares tremendously about this legislation. However, he had an event for Holocaust Remembrance in his district, which was long scheduled. So I guess, quick question for you.
Sure.
How did you learn about this event? Did the short notice impact your ability to provide testimony or prepare?
I actually learned about it through my attorney, who monitors these things for me, and had notified me last week that there would be a hearing and asked if I would like to testify, and I said, sure.
Great. Thank you very much. And do you have positions on any of the other items, such as 294, which would cap the credit card fee, or how do your clients generally pay their fines and fees?
The general public generally pays by credit card, and I have not had a negative response to the credit card fee from the general public. They understand they're paying those fees everywhere. I think they kind of expect that there's going to be a fee to pay by credit card. So I can't say that I've had any objection to it. I think the payment by credit card is very helpful. I think and you can pay it through our phone app by credit card, and vast majority of our customers who are found guilty at hearing do pay through the credit card without any objection or problem.
Do you think that, why do you think it is at finance that they Why do you think at Finance they've given this directive around discretion? Do you believe that at oath the hearing officers will have more discretion?
I think under the prior administration, it was simply a money grab. I believe that the current chief administrative law judge would be happy to entertain the process of giving that flexibility back to the administrative law judges. I don't know what Commissioner Jiha's position is on that, but I think the judges would be happy with it, and if it went to oath, it might be easier to do. I just don't know what the administration's position is, but I think it would actually be a boon to the general public and to the city to dispense with the penalty issue. I mean, if you don't show up and your ticket gets into judgment, you should be hammered with all the penalties possible if you're a scofflaw. Most people are not scofflaws. They're going in with a $115 ticket, and now it's $125. Relieve the $10 penalty.
Under criminal justice reform, we're now reevaluating penalties, and instead of slamming people with penalties, we're looking at community service. Do you think that would be positive if we moved Parking Violations Bureau to oath, if oath hearing officers were able to offer residents who had violated the parking rules the opportunity of doing community service instead of having to just pay a fine?
I think that might be a little extreme, simply because of the volumes. I mean, there's just hundreds of thousands of respondents. That would be so unwieldy. I don't think we could manage saying, okay, you're going to do some community service. And again, especially the fines and the penalties are not huge for the individual. So I think it's going to be hard to equate it. But I do think that we would get more compliance if we had people feeling like I could go in, plead my case, and get something back from the city.
Thank you very much for your testimony. We'll excuse you as a witness.
Thank you, Council Member.
If members of the public, if members of the press who are here have specific questions about the administration's testimony, which has been submitted on the papers, we will be forwarding questions to them on everything from what other actions they're taking and as well as other means of getting to the same issues given their positions on some of this legislation. We're going to go into recess while we await certain committee members who we have multiple committee meetings here today. And at that point, we will gavel out once members return.